Hey guys, this is Alachi, and this is my review for Totally Killer. This is a movie that my husband showed me the trailer to a few weeks ago, and I was like, this is so a you movie. You know, basically anything to do with time travel, aliens, or superheroes, and he's just like, there's some sort of like antennae that goes off where he's like, ooh. So I saw the trailer, and I was like, this looks pretty freaking silly. However, it did seem like it could be a fun film for Halloween. It's basically like a true crime podcast meets Back to the Future. Unfortunately, dialed down to really, really dumb. Now, here's the thing. Some of these movies, you know, you watch them and you're just like, you're hoping that it's a type of movie that is so bad it's good. But, you know, you always run the risk of whether or not it's a bad movie that's just bad. And this is one of those films where I feel like the hook was actually very, very interesting. The movie starts off incredibly well, very unique, but then falls into a very nagging, whiny type of film where a lot of the jokes and the parts that are supposed to be funny should have just been allowed to breathe instead of just constantly being nailed and preached down your throat where you're like, okay, I get it. You know, there is this Gen V versus Gen X type of comparison. And when they let the jokes of that kind of the shock value of someone from the 2020s existing in 1987, you know, that's where it's sort of like, ha, I chuckled out loud. However, when you have, you know, the Gen Z basically reaming the Gen X for their behavior, constantly just, you know, not letting the joke just kind of slide, but just constantly going like, hey, guys, we got to point this out. That's where I think this film gets very, very tedious. Not to mention the fact that the plot definitely drags as the main heroine is trying to solve these mysteries. So the premise is that back in 1987, there were three teenage girls who were all murdered, stabbed 16 times, you know, true crime thriller stuff, you know, the Sweet 16 killer who was never found. There was a fourth friend who was not killed, and her name was Pam. Pam has a daughter, Jamie, played by Kiernan Shipka, who you've seen in maybe in Sabrina, or she was in Flowers in the Attic, and a couple other things as well. But I think she's most known for Netflix's Sabrina. And she plays Jamie, the daughter of Pam, who is the one survivor of this 1987 killing. And her mother, Pam, is constantly always warning her, like, you got to be careful, you know, all three of my friends were murdered back in the day. And then, you know, the teenage daughter is just like, whatever. And so the premise is that something happens that's quite large and big in scale in terms of like the opening of Scream. It kind of has that opening to it, only like a little bit of subversion, because the opening victim is very, very well prepared, which I thought was actually very entertaining. However, once Jamie gets to a point in the beginning of the movie where she's like, I need to find out who this killer is. You know, I'm finally like, you know, as much as my mom used to nag me about this killer all the time, and I never really paid attention, now I really want to solve this murder. And so she connects with Chris Dubasage, the podcaster, who's been podcasting about the Sweet 16 killer for a long time. She then turns to her best friend, who has been, for the science fair project, has been building a time machine. And this is when she goes to her best friend, who is building a time machine for a science fair project. That's kind of where I mentally checked out. I was like, do you guys hear that? The sticker is, it fell. Do you see that? I put these stickers back here. My nephew is visiting. He's really into Super Mario Brothers. And those things, I just put them on. They do not stick. They do not stick to certain walls. And I have those type of walls where they don't stick to. So I don't know how long that's going to last. Anyways, back to the review. So she's just like, you know, it's very much Back to the Future where Marty McFly goes to Doc Brown. It's like, hey, man, you know, like, what's happening? Doc Brown's like, I just happen to be building this, you know, crazy thing. You need to come see what it does. You know, in this case, she's just sort of like, hey, you built this time machine for the science fair project. And I'm just like, at that point, you kind of know where the film is going in terms of like how it's basically going to use time travel as a fix-all for all plot devices and ignore every single time travel rule that could possibly be set up. You know how like people are always saying, you know, there's an established kind of set of principles that you and rules that you fix to at the beginning of your film and you kind of stick with that, especially in terms of time travel. In this case, doesn't freaking matter. It's just like time travel. We're having fun. Who cares? This is a teenage horror film. Doesn't really matter. I would say if it weren't for the fact that when the killings actually occur, they are quite gruesome, I would say it is a very preteenish kind of film in terms of like the quality of dialogue, the mannerisms of which the how the plot unfolds. So anyways, needless to say, Jamie gets transported from 2020 something to 1987, where she is now a 17-year-old in 1987, who is now experiencing what it's like as a Gen X teenager in a Gen X high school. And that is where the main sense of humor, source of humor comes from. It's that kind of fish out of water type humor. And, you know, the mascot of the high school are, you know, Red Devils. And then basically there's like no security because this is way before school shootings were like in every freaking month occurrence. There is a lot of, you know, just non-babying, you know, that, you know, I think Gen Zers are used to in terms of just how we're allowed to, like, just even the toys we used to have back in the day, like, would be considered threat level, like, 100 right now. And that's just kind of, like, where I found, like, most of the really, really funny parts occurring is where she's just sort of, like, unwanted touch, you know, I don't give you permission to touch me, you know, you're just, like... You know, this is back when schools where they actually were allowed to, like, you know, issue out corporal punishment. So it's those parts are very interesting. However, she's back in 1987 and she is determined to stop the Sweet 16 killer from ever murdering those three girls in the first place. And these three girls are horny, ditzy, just typical 80s high school girlish mean girls, and they're just so unlikable. And but she's constantly just nagging at them, not constantly, you gotta be careful, you have to be careful, like, let's call the police, let's not have a party, let's not get drunk, let's do some really boring stuff. And that, like, is a giant portion that another sticker is about to fall. Oh, Mario, you're going down. Oh. Oh, those things suck. Yeah, so she's constantly just nagging at them. And that is a giant portion of this film, is her nagging at these teenagers, constantly trying to stop them from doing things that teenagers do. And she just becomes this like mother figure that's just always whining and preaching and teaching and warning. And you're just like, oh man, like, this is a fun flick, right? Your best friend has a time machine. You're back in 1987 trying to stop a killer. This is a fun movie. This is supposed to be like a let's just like go with it type of fun film. But she's just this anchor that's constantly weighing down like this, the over the top fun plot, which I found really like disappointing in the film, which, you know, it should have been like a just total, like, whatever, you know, like, let's just ignore everything, let's just have fun type film. But because she is this total Gen Z nagger, it's so frustrating. And I think it's really fun to see a Gen Zer go into Gen X and just be like, what the hell? The 80s were crazy, man. Like, the whole culture was completely different. And it would just been far more interesting to see her integrate with that rather than just constantly tell everyone like, hey, man, you can't say that. You can't do that. You can't say that. You can't say that. That's not acceptable. You know, oh, Mario, down. God dang it. I knew that was a bad idea. And so, you know, by the time the big reveal happens where you find out why these girls were murdered, it gets to be super freaking serious. And you're just like, holy crap, that is a huge freaking downer. I mean, just like to the point where you're like, you know, are we really upset that these girls were killed? Because holy crap, they weren't innocent, you know? And that's kind of all I'm going to tease about that, because I have a feeling a lot of people will want to check this out because it does look like a so bad it's good film. But I got to say, I'm going to warn you, it's a so bad it's bad film. But, you know, my husband enjoyed it. He was like, hey, I thought it was just outrageous, stupid, and fun. But I found it just a little grating. Is this your type of film? This is just so not my type of film. Just because it's too serious for a film that's just like, that's supposed to be super fun. There is a portion, you know, where because it's based off of Back to the Future, it has a time travel element where, you know, things in the past affect the future. So when she finally does come back into the present time, things have changed so drastically and mathematically things don't add up. I'm just like, what the hell? I feel like it made no sense. It was just complete fantasy weirdness. And you're just like, by the time it resolves, you're just like, okay, you know, fine. But hey, man, I plan on making a video about this pretty soon, but Hollywood is in a massive drought and there's just not much to watch. So you're probably going to watch it because there's nothing out there, man, like nothing. It's just a sea of really bad horror films and then nothing. I think the next big movie that's coming out is Killers of the Flower Moon and then The Marvels. And then it's just nothing. I think I'm going to take these things down, or I don't know how to make these things stick more. Whatever. If you know, let me know. It's probably going to be too late by the time. oh gosh, one of them's coming down again. Oh, what a travesty. I'm going to have to leave a bad review on Amazon for those. Anyways, let me know what you guys thought about Totally Killer. And if you think it's a so bad it's good film or a so bad it's just dumb film. All right, guys, thanks so much for watching. If you'd like to watch more, you can click right here or here to watch more now. Until next time, see you on the flip side. Boom, 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 boom